There are lots of different ways to create texture with paste and gels, with each type of media producing some sort of 3D effect. The downside is the dry time, which can run upward of an hour or more depending on the thickness of the layer and atmospheric conditions. Enter Andy Skinner's lava paste. In today's 5 minutes of fun video, I'll show you just how fast and easy building texture can be. This really is a simple product. All you do is apply it to your surface, add heat, and then watch the texture form. Now, the best part of something this simple is how easy it is to alter the step a little bit, and you can really change the outcome. For example, how thick you apply the lava paste makes a big difference in the result, as does whether you apply it in a smooth layer versus something that's already got some peaks and valleys and highs and lows. You can color lava paste, which is going to give you an entirely different look. You can add multiple layers, and by that I mean add a layer, heat it to set it, and make it form texture, and then put another layer on top. You'll get a much more dimensional result that way. You can also do something like sprinkle glitter on it before you heat it and then put another layer on it, and I'm going to show you that too. In general, you can expect it to take maybe 2 to 3 minutes for the lava paste to react. The thinner the layer, obviously the quicker that's going to happen because there's less water that has to evaporate out of it, but it will affect how much texture you get. So this was, let me hold that so you can see it. This was a pretty thin layer that I swiped on. It did not take long to heat at all, but you can see up here there's a little bit more texture because it was a little bit thicker. And then when you look at something, again, let me turn this so you can see it. When you look at something like this, which is actually very dimensional, this was a much, much thicker layer. So let's kind of do the basics and put a layer on. I'm going to use a palette knife. It's one of the easiest ways to, that I find to apply it, but you can use a brush. You can put it through a stencil, so we'll see all of that too, although I'm not necessarily going to use a brush this time, but it can be done that way because you'll see the brush strokes when the texture starts to form. So I'm going to put a pretty thin layer there, and then I'm going to go a little bit thicker here. Now on this thin layer, I want to keep it reasonably smooth, but over here, I'm going to add some texture to begin with, and you'll see how that really does affect the outcome. Now, this is supposed to be a 5 minutes of fun video, and while it's fun, I'm not entirely certain I can keep it to 5 minutes just because we have a certain amount of time that has to be spent waiting for the product to heat and dry. Obviously, things like humidity and the ambient temperature are all going to affect that, but the primary thing that will affect how long it takes for this to happen is how thick that layer is. So I'm going to just let this happen. I'm not going to talk through it, and then when it's done, I'll turn it so that you can actually see it. As this begins to dry and react, you'll see that it's getting a little bit lighter in here because that's a thin area. You'll see the bubbles start to form, so that's already happening up here on the peaks where I really made some dimension in the lava paste. You can see where it's a little bit thicker here. I'm getting a little bit bigger bubbles, and I'm going to concentrate on this right now. I will tell you, you don't want to put this right on top of it. I am trying to keep the heat moving. You can burn the product if you hold too much direct heat right on it, so I generally try to keep my heat tool moving like this, but you can see that I still need to put, let me turn this toward you. You can see right here, I still need heat there because it hasn't actually finished reacting, and there's a whole section over here that still has to react. Alright, I'm going to let that be done. I'm not going to heat the whole thing because I don't want this to take any longer than it really needs to. Where it's dark, you know that that hasn't fully dried and hasn't fully reacted yet, and so there will be more dimension there. But for the meantime, I did want to show you this. So again, I put this on pretty smooth. If I hold this up, this is curved a little bit. If I hold this up, you can see that there is a little bit of dimension here, but there's nothing there that really compares to what happens here because I textured that before I even started to heat it. So with that said, let me show you something else. Now Andy, I've watched him a couple of times and he applies it, I'm going to turn it this way, he applies it with a brayer, and that's how you get this kind of tree bark effect. But this was not done with a single layer, it was actually done with three. So here's one that I've already started. This has a single layer with the brayer already applied and it's already been heated. So what I'm going to do is put another layer on because I want to show you that by building multiple layers, you can build texture completely differently than if you simply go ahead and do the one layer. So again, using the brayer really creates a much different look. And I think that Andy's absolutely right. It very much looks like tree bark. So if you enjoy working with texture, you're going to love this stuff. Now I'm going to just quickly wipe the excess off. Ordinarily, I wouldn't waste it, but for the sake of brevity, because again, I am trying desperately to stay within 5 minutes, I'm just going to put that to one side now, and in comes the heat tool again. So I kept my layers pretty thin on this one, and you can see that my dots are not, or my little bumps there, are not nearly as exaggerated as what they are here, because again, the layer is thin and there's not a ton of texture to begin with. And by that I mean I didn't leave texture in the paste. So this is what we're going for. And I'm starting to see results come up here, so I'm going to move over here a little bit. Again, it's still dark, so I know that there's some reaction that still has to happen there. But it really is, it's this building of layers that means you can create some really extreme three-dimensional textural looks. All right, we're going to call that done. So here is my piece with, again, this is not completely done. If you look at the bubbles on this piece, which are much smaller, that's because there was less of the product applied each time. I put a little bit too much up here, or at least too much for what I was trying to achieve in this area right here. So my bubbles are a little bit bigger, but by keeping it to thinner layers and building multiple versions is how you can get this kind of a look. So things continue to get more interesting. You can add what I think of as inclusions. So this is some of the Cosmic Shimmer. This is one of the shimmer shakers. I put some on when I applied the first layer. So here's another one in process. This is what this one started like. I put the lava paste on and then I sprinkled some of the glitter on top and then I heated it, and that's how it gets to this stage. But if you'll look here, you can see that the glitter is very much in the background, because what I did was I came back and I added another layer on top. So I'm going to just quickly do that. I'm not going to spend a ton of time on this, but I do want to show you that it's possible to take that glitter and really push it into the background, because I've put layers over the top that are going to conceal some of it. So this is kind of the process. Again, I'm going with real thick thin because I like this kind of bubbly big texture thing that can happen. I'm trying to cover that clot of glitter right there just to kind of smooth it out a little bit so it's not so obvious. All right, clean that off. Let's bring in the heat tool again. All right, we're almost to the point where this is done. I don't see any more dark spots. And you can, I'm going to hold this way, you can see how much texture there is on there. I've created all of these wonderful high spots that I could come back and do something else to. I've pushed the glitter to the background, but I've given this such a textural, sculptural 3D look. I think that it's really interesting. So this one obviously is a little bit thicker than this one. How much you add, how much texture you add to the paste before you heat it, of course, is always going to matter. Now you can add lava paste. I knew I was going to call it texture paste at least once. You can put lava paste through a stencil. This is one of our number 8 watercolor tags, and you can see that this is pretty smooth. It's not quite as smooth as this sample right here, but you can see that the bubbles that are on here are very, very small. That's because when I scraped the material, this is our whirligig stencil, when I scraped lava paste through the stencil, I made certain that that surface was quite flat before I went ahead and pulled the stencil off. So you can, once this stuff cools, you can put stuff on top. So you can dry brush with paint if you want. This is Nuvo Embellishment Mousse. You can use Embellishment Mousse. This color is, what is this? This is Royal Aubergine. So that's what I did here. Now, earlier I said that you can, in fact, tint this. You shouldn't probably add any more than maybe 10 or 12% of whatever you're adding to tint the color to your lava paste, but you can certainly get some cool color that way. And I've used a little bit of red. Now obviously Cosmic Shimmer makes their own version of this. It's called Gilding Polish. Lots of different colors available. I'm going to grab this one just because I want to look at the purple on top of the pink that I've already done there. So whether you use something like, not lava paste, whether you use something like embellishment mousse or Gilding Polish, you can come in and hit the high spots on here. Now, obviously, with something like embellishment mousse or gilding paste, I'm going to get a metallic look because of the nature of the product. But if you wanted to do this with just regular paint, you could certainly do that. And then at that point, what you're getting is just the color without the shine. But as you know, I'm all about the shine, so I really like to do it this way. So this is Andy Skinner's Lava Paste. I think it's a really cool product. I think that there are lots of applications from, and as I said, this is watercolor paper. So there's nothing that says you have to add this to wood or a piece of MDF or a really thick piece of chipboard. This is 140-pound watercolor paper. It works really well, and it remains flexible. So I put it on, this is just a piece of canvas. I put it on here. This is multiple layers. Again, it flexes perfectly well. So this is Andy Skinner's Lava Paste. I think it's a really interesting product, and there's lots of applications in our mixed media and art journaling world.